Father, we want to give ourselves to excellence. Lord, to give ourselves to excellence in praise. There is absolutely nothing that you could do with your life that would be more glorious, more beautiful, and more wonderful than you having achieved or attained a place of excellence in praise, a place of excellence in thanksgiving, to be able to cunningly, by the realms of the anointing of the Holy Ghost, move with the Spirit of the Lord as God teaches us how to enter into the gates with thanksgiving, enter into his courts with praise, to move in these expressions of God the Holy Spirit, who alone can glorify Jesus and give us the ability to do it. Oh, what if you just shut everything else down in your life? Shut everything down in your life. So he said, well, I'm going to give myself to a vow of poverty. I heard somebody say they're going to give themselves to a vow of prosperity. Oh, goodness gracious. Both of them are just as ridiculous. How many of you gave yourself to a vow of learning how to praise most excellently? To love most excellently. Oh, come on now. Father has gotten whatever's the leftovers for so long from God's people. It's just not going to be that way. Just say it's just not going to be that way. Then that's going to take a whole lot. Maybe you have high expectations of people, but do you have high enough expectation of yourself? Maybe you want to be able to do all these various different things, but are you willing to do them? And what is it that's the most important in the realms of seeking the kingdom of God? Worship. Worship. Worship him. Worship on the Bailey. Worship him. Worship him. Worship him with the keyboard. Worship him on the string instrument. Worship him on the drums and on the cymbals. Worship him in the dance. Hallelujah. Worship him on the Koda Si Prataya. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him on the high sounding cymbal. Praise him on the string instruments and the organs. Praise him. Praise him. You aren't ready. You're not ready. You're not ready. You're not ready. See, you got to be prepared. You got to be prepared. Because nobody can hear what you're doing. It don't matter. You know what? If you're a mute, I mean, come on. You know what I'm saying? You may praise excellently inside your head, but nobody can hear anything. Ain't nobody going to profit from it. God wants to use you. God wants to use your realms and expressions of his divine glory that is unimaginable to you. And he's going to train you as you learn how to talk with him, as you become fluent in prayer, fluent in requesting those things that he has requested, fluent in just confessing those things which he has confessed about us, petitioning him for those things which he's required of us, talking to him out of his own counsel to us, praising and thanksgiving because of all that he's done when he gave his only begotten son, that God was willing to humble himself and become a human being, became fashioned like sinful flesh, to condemn sin in the flesh, to suffer, to die for us, to learn obedience to that which he suffered, to bring many sons to glory, to become the only begotten son that we may become sons. Amazing. 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 You want to learn the song of the Spirit, and you don't want to just stay where you've been. You want to press in for what God's given us an invitation to. And I'm telling you right now, you listen to me. It's dimension upon dimension upon dimension. It is ever increasing. It's to the full. It's glorious. You can't ever sit back and say, well, that's good enough. This is the way I like to do it. My goodness, that's not hunger and thirsting. That's not truth towards God. That's not passionate about seeing that which is there in Christ Jesus as he reveals all heaven as the fullness of God is made manifest through him. I hope you came and brought your door knocker tonight. so you can be heard as you banging on the heaven's door, as you knocking, seeking, and asking. Come on, man. We only talk about it so you can do it. We don't talk about it for information only. Some of you are still looking like, well, I heard that before. Yeah, but you never did it before. So it doesn't matter why you heard it before. Or maybe you did it once and God wants you to do it all the time and He wants you to be an ever-increasing manifestation of His glory. Father wants to use you to praise louder when everybody else is praising. Father wants you to use you to bust through in the realms of the anointing when everybody else is just floating. Must it only be one person all the time that knows how to break through the troop and go get a drink of water? Who knows how to draw water from the well? Must it just be one or two or just a few on the earth while everybody else just is subdued? So I'm talking to you tonight about stir yourself up. Hey! Quit acting like this is all about you. Take up your cross. Come follow Jesus. Amen. One person clapping. Praise God. One person. I'm just so glad you came tonight. I am so blessed. I am so blessed that I get to minister to one person. Somebody's hooked up. Everybody else is just like, oh, he's talking bad about me again. Jesus, help us. Let there be valiant men. Let there be valiant women. Come on now. Hallelujah. Tonight is I'm going to talk to you about being an overcomer. Merry Christmas. You know, the thing about it is I think that the most unattended Sundays in all of the church is when Christmas comes on a Sunday. And it's not because that people are going out of town, because that is normalized. That's equivalent. As many people went out of town as came into town. Do you understand what I'm saying? That's normalized. It's because people make Christmas about family rather than about God. God's people make Christmas about family rather than about God. It's nuts. I mean, it should be so blatantly, obviously wrong that everybody go, ooh, that's bad. But unfortunately, we're not that smart. We didn't have that much perception. Huh? Praise God for His mercy. We're a bunch of street people that were invited in. Amen. The people who were invited didn't come, so He said, go out in the highways and the byways and get the street people. That my house might be full. I'm a street person. I'm the highway and the byway guy. So are you. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let the flow of the Holy Ghost just take a hold of you right now. Sweep you in. Now, what I mean by that was, I didn't mean for you to close your eyes. Lift your hands. I meant for you to just disarm yourself. Let God begin to speak with tongues of interpretation, tongues through you. Tonight I want you to walk out of here and I want you to be so bold about doing the works of Jesus, about casting out devils, about commanding sickness and disease, about shutting down sin. And what happens is people all of a sudden, they just give up. They say, it's too complicated. I've tried so hard. I tried to talk them into it. People won't listen to me. I'm just going to leave them alone. That's where you just opted out in the kingdom of God. Father wants us to be passionate, ferocious about these things, insistent, demanding. Demanding. And I'm going to just tell you right now, I want to make sure that you understand when I'm communicating to you about these things, I'm looking around saying, where are the demanding people? That's right. Come on. That's right. You first one, raise your hand, and you are a demanding person. That's right. People start to raise their hands now because they won't be left out, poor guys. Come late to the feast. But you know what? Better late to the party than never. Huh? It's okay to be a follower. God wants to raise you up to be a leader. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. It's okay to be a planet. God wants to raise you up to be a star. Huh? Start shining bright. Amen. Instead of just reflecting some light a little bit. Kato rabote ate montake kashtongle kapatai. God the Holy Ghost is here. With signs and wonders and demonstrations of power, you can't be locked down in whatever it is that you're in. I told people over it again how to get out of their sickness. It's to begin to worship and praise. But if they don't learn how to worship and praise when they're healthy, how are they ever going to learn how to worship and praise when they're sick? Must I try to give you a convincing argument to prove what I just said is true? Do you hear me?
Yes.
You got to learn how to just let everything go. Let everything that would hold you back become no longer important to you. Ah, not your favorite little song and your little tune and your whatever, but whatever is rather going on, you just get fully engaged in it.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, I don't like that particular beat. I don't like that particular tune. That isn't my favorite song that really moves me. Song not supposed to move you anyways. You're supposed to move the song. I move the song. Song doesn't move me. Huh? I move the song because I'm moved by one person and him alone, the Holy Ghost. I'm virtuous towards God. I don't have a bunch of different things going on. Are you listening to me? Come on, people. Getting here in time enough to turn up your instrument so somebody can hear what you're playing. Huh? Get here in time enough to tune up your instrument. Now, some of you, I'm just talking about your voice through prayer. Crying out to God, get laying hold on Him. He's there. Whether you believe or not, ain't gonna make a bit of difference. He's there. And your belief ain't gonna add to or take away from Him. You just get an opportunity to be recipient of all that He has to give and all the wonders of His goodness. And you don't have to press in past yourself, past your doubt, your issues, your drama, your stuff. Huh? Your failures, your shortcomings, your whatever. People sit around and talk about their dysfunctional issues. I jumped out of mine through praise and worship. I jumped right out of them. They jumped right out of them. You want to talk about what hurt them, what offended them? My goodness. I mounted up with wings and left it behind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I left those scraps for the dogs. I left those scraps for the dogs. Picking around in that mess. Come on. Picking around in that mess. Come on. Come on. Picking around in that mess. Woo! Hallelujah. My faults, my failings, my issues, my drama, all that. Left that scrap for the dogs.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Just be clothed with glory and majesty. You be clothed. You clothed. You be clothed with, woo, with honor. Huh? Woo, with praise. Be clothed with thanksgiving. Be clothed with the Spirit. Be clothed with Christ Jesus. Be clothed with the heavenly. Be clothed with the good things of God. Be clothed with His goodness. Be clothed with His life. Be clothed with all that He's freely given. Because you're not willing to be without it. You're not be willing to be without it. You know, I've just always been caught away in God. People say, who does He think He is? You know why they would say, who does He think He is? Because I gave them no measure of attention or value concerning what they thought about what I was doing. Mine was solely to heaven. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Come on, people. Satan always trying to interrupt, run interference. Huh? People trying to demand that you ask their permission first. In we got direct access. We don't have to ask anybody's permission, man. Father wants to teach you how to access the heavenly realm by the Spirit and open heaven to be able to see angels ascending and descending upon the Son of Man, all the power and the glory of God given to us through Him. I mean, that all our eyes open to behold that we're in the house of God, a revelation that His the chariot of the Lord and the horsemen thereof are on our side, and fill the whole of the earth that surrounds us. I tell you, our open eyes to see God the Holy Ghost standing right here, moving in our lives, in us and with us, the empowerment of angels that have come to give to us ministry, power, ministry, ability. Hallelujah. Unbelievable. Sent to be ministers for those who are heirs of salvation. You guys get open. You guys start dancing around here. Jesus. I want you to press into the new song. I want you to press into the song of the Spirit. Nobody's interested in anybody's copyright. Are you listening to me? Nobody's interested in anybody's poetry. Are we interested in the song of the Spirit? Huh? We'll try to get past your inability to sing, some of you. Because it's still beautiful to the Father. It's not inspirational to the rest of us. Praise God for people who do know how to sing. Because it's inspirational when the anointing is upon. It's inspirational to some degree when the anointing's not even on it, just human. But what happens when all of a sudden we become skillful in that which God alone can teach? Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want you to sit down. I'm going to minister to some things to you. I want you to grab a hold of it. I did not want you to sit here. I don't want you to sit here just acting like you hear. I want you to sit here tonight acting like you paying attention. Huh? I want you to grab a hold and start receiving something from God here in this place. I want you to begin to respond to and move with the Spirit. Everybody who's trying to figure out the Spirit, the things of the Spirit, says they know how the moving of the Spirit works. They are stopped before they get started. Because the Holy Ghost is like the wind. You don't know where it's going to come from next. Tell me, where is it going to come from next? And then where is it going to turn to? Now, all you can do is hear the sound of it. All you can do is be touched by it, blown around by it. The Lord wants to teach us how to put up the sail and let the wind of the Spirit blow us where He will.
Yes.
Now, if you're going to try to manage that, you've got to have a rudder. But on this river, you're not allowed to have a rudder. He said, no rudder's allowed. He's just going to blow us around where He willeth. Why don't you let God, the Holy Ghost, blow you around where He willeth? Why don't you let the manifestation of the Spirit be given to you according as the Holy Ghost wills tonight? And He's willing. He's willing. Don't clam up on me now because I'm now. Don't clam up on me because now you feel like you've got to do something. The pressure's on. Thank you, Jesus. Come sit down. Come listen. Pressure is on. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. Now listen. Those of you who are being constantly overcome with things, overwhelmed with things, tripped up, messed up, constantly feeling like, you know, you're failing, you're getting overcome by situations that are belong to the world, belong to sin, I've got your solutions here tonight. I can tell you why, and I can tell you how to prevent it. Now, if you don't cooperate, if you continue to go ahead and do the same thing that you've been doing, you're going to get the same results. But if you'll obey God and you'll come and receive that which He supplied, then there's no power of darkness to be able to take you. Nothing to be able to stand against you. And before I get into the depths of this tonight, I want you to hear just a couple of things. One of them is one of the Psalms of David that is recorded in 1 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 9. The scripture says, "He will keep the feet of his saints." And he's really talking about you and I not slipping, walking upon high places and having feet like hinds' feet. Huh?
Yes.
Like the elk, or like the deer, or like the mountain goat, or like the mountain sheep. You look them run straight up that cliff. Yeah. That's where they go. You want to hunt elk and you want to hunt mountain sheep, you got to go where you can't climb. Because they have the ability to have such perfect footing on something that there is nothing to foot on, as it would appear. And in this context, the Lord is saying, just as the prophet said, Habakkuk said, "He shall make my feet like hinds' feet, and none of my steps shall slip." Huh? The Lord keeps the steps of his saints, of his holy ones. And I'm going to tell you right now, that isn't some kind of sovereign, predestinated will of God. That is something that you and I participate with. We yield ourselves to him. We give ourselves over to him. We allow him to take care of us, uphold us, strengthen us. And that is a participation that comes out of relationship. And I'm going to talk to you about that relationship that many times you've heard it over and over again, and you've just not done it. And now is an opportunity, as we're moving into the new calendar year, for you to just get a hold of yourself, grab a hold of yourself, and say, "I'm all by God. I'm going to walk with God. I'm giving myself complete consignment over to God. I'm going to quit making this all about me and take up my cross and follow Jesus." Hallelujah. Praise God forevermore. Come on now. He says he keeps the feet of his holy ones, and the wicked, and he says, "He shall keep the feet of his saints, and the wicked shall be silent in darkness, for by strength shall no man prevail." One of the most important things that you've got to grab a hold of is your strength and your ability will not do. It will not make the cut here. You will not be an overcomer. You will not be any more than a conqueror. You will not find yourself walking out this life that Father has so freely given to us by his Holy Spirit. You got to learn something. We'll just go ahead and grab it too real quickly as I'm heading over to the text that the Lord's laid on my heart tonight. Just look in Zechariah chapter 3. It's a verse of scripture that is quoted by a lot of people. People have sung the verse of scripture, but I'm concerned that very few people have been willing to grab a hold of it. The Lord tells us it's not by might, it's not by power. He's talking to Zerubbabel, who he's given a place and a commission to in the ministry of his kingdom. But he says, "Hey, listen, Zerubbabel, listen, you got to understand, this is what God says, this is what the Almighty says. It's not by human might, it's not by human power, it's not by human strength, it's not by human ability. By the strength of man, by a man's strength, he shall not prevail. He will not be successful. He's not going to win the battle. It's not by might, it's not by power, but it's by my spirit," says the Lord. And this has got to be everything that sets for us a desperate, needy state where we're now willing to yield to God the Holy Ghost on a continual and daily basis to deal with the things that we're being faced with. And so I think the best way to set up for you what we're being faced with is for you to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 6. And I believe it's verse 12. We'll just look over there at that, because somebody got the wrong memo. And I want to make sure that everybody's on the same page. Somebody got the wrong memo. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, the Apostle Paul didn't get the memo that a lot of folks have gotten. A lot of people just say, "Well, the battle's over. The war has been won." Well, you know what? That is true with respect to what Jesus Christ did at Calvary, but you and I are in the midst of a fight. You and I are in the midst of a warfare, and we better get this thing right. We better get square. squared away with the consequences of our decisions. We better get squared away with what is really going to make the difference of whether or not we overcome. Because if you're relying upon your discipline, your strength, your human ability, you fail. You don't get to move in any realms of that which God, the Holy Ghost, alone can supply. You never get the splendor of heaven. You'll always have that which will a fading glory. Huh? Because that's what man has. All the glory of man is like the grass of the field, the flower thereof that fades away. It's a failing glory. Are you with me? Huh? Who wants that? That's not why you're here tonight. God has made this easy, but you've got to participate with what he said. We've got to participate with what he said. If he's going to have a people in the earth that he can move with and that he can move through. So we look here in 1 Timothy chapter 6, and Paul says, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life. Wow. I want you to fight the good fight of faith, and I want you to have a firm grip on your eternal life. And a couple of things before I go too deep in this, it's very important for me to emphasize to you. So just go quickly over to 1 John chapter 5. I just pick it there because I think in 1 John chapter 5, God says it at least three times by his servant that we have eternal life right now. It's something that we right now possess. You got to have a firm grip on the eternal life that you've been given, because the eternal life is the life of God. It's not something that we are earning. It's the life that has been imparted to us. It's the life of Jesus Christ. It's the overcoming life. It's the greater one who's on the inside of us. It's the working power of the Holy Spirit, which nothing in this world, not the lust of the flesh, not the lust of the eye, not the pride of life, has one moment of opportunity to overthrow. Satan cannot overthrow God. That battle's already been fought and won. It's decided the champion's Jesus. Yes. That one's done, but yours isn't. Yours isn't. You have to understand, you've got to fight the good fight of faith, and you've got to have a firm grip on eternal life. That is the realm. It's not only the reward, it is the realm of the power and divine ability to succeed in God, to be an overcomer in dealing with all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life. You do not have to do signs and wonders and demonstration of the power of God to be able to be right with God and make heaven. God has that for every person, don't get me wrong. But one thing for sure is, you cannot live a life of sin. You cannot live a life of iniquity. You cannot live a life of participating with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life and make heaven. You're just not going to do it. God makes it very, very clear. Those folks won't inherit the kingdom of God. And that is certainly one dimension in which Paul is describing Timothy that he's got to deal with. Here, Timothy, he's an elder in the church. He's a minister in the church. He's pastoring in a bishopry type of a position. He's also doing the work of an evangelist. He's had a good confession among many people. He's received an anointing. Paul's talking about, told him, stir up the gift that he'd received by the impartation of the laying on of hands. But he's telling this warrior in God, listen, you better toughen up here. You better stand up. You better get alert here. You better understand how to engage in this contest that is now, this war that is raging about you. You better get your firm grip on eternal life and recognize what your source of authority and power and divine ability is. And with that, fight a good fight. People believe that somehow we don't need to be fighting, that there's no fight. They just, they've got a new doctrine different than what Paul taught. Because Paul was very, very clear about you and I laying hold of a strength and a divine power and ability to be able to stand against the spiritual wickedness. He's very clear about the powers of darkness that wages war against us. So is Peter. Very clear about the powers of darkness that wages war against us with fleshly lust. So let's go over here quickly. Let's look at an example here in Hebrews of Moses. Let's see how well he did without being born again, without being made a new creation, without being filled with the Spirit, without an encounter at the burning bush. No burning bush encounter. Are you listening to me? Yes. Let's just see how well he did. Let's see how well he stood up against it. Let's see if you and I can even compare in any way to what he was willing to do simply because he laid hold on the Word of God. Because what was there, he didn't have the new nature, he wasn't born again, he wasn't filled with the Spirit, but he had something available to him that was an overcoming power called faith. And so we look here in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 20, I think it's 23, 24, let's just get over there and look and we'll find it real quick. Oh yeah, it's just started up here, verse 23. But by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months. Now, he didn't have anything to do with that. Huh? His mom moved there. She believed in God's plan. She saw something that God was doing. What'd she do? When she saw something that God was doing, what'd she do? She threw in with it and fully cooperated with him. By faith, Moses was hid 3 months by his parents because they saw that there was something unique about him. They saw that there was a call of God upon his life. They saw that he was a proper child. And they were not afraid of the king's commandments. So listen, it doesn't matter. God's going to take care of them. The call of God's there. And, you know, and we could start parsing that out and breaking that down and thinking, wow, why didn't everybody, you know, do the same thing? But, you know, we don't want to get into that because it's a sidetrack. But listen to this. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. I want you to listen to this. Without all that we have now been resourced with through this wonderful provision of God's only begotten Son, through this wonderful work of redemption that we now are on the full receiving end of, through this wonderful ministry of the Holy Ghost and baptismal power, many of God's people, many of God's people are sore afflicted and sore tormented by the powers of darkness that they do not know how to overcome or make a choice to say, no, I'm not going to enjoy the pleasures of the world. I'm not going to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Rather, I'm going to give myself over to participating with God's people and what God's purposed us to do, no matter what it costs me. In terms of the creature comforts, in terms of the reputation, in terms of the finances, returns of all these other things. Think about this. Think about this contrast, people. Because the bottom line of it is, there's pleasures in sin. There are pleasures in sin. Otherwise, there's none of us would ever be tempted by it. There are pleasures in sin, but those pleasures ultimately have a consequence. That consequence is death. And God said, telling you and me, you better lay hold on. You better get your firm grip on eternal life and understand that through it, you're in the midst of a battle and that you're going to have to stand against the fleshly lust that war against your soul, because otherwise, if you do not, it's going to take you out. So we hear concerning Moses, he chose rather to suffer affliction. Well, I don't even think the Pentecostal movement even has any ability to relate to that in the first place. He chose to suffer affliction rather to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproaches of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he had respect. And in other words, he had a passion, he had a preference, he had a desire that went way beyond everything earthly. He had a respect, he had a passion, he had a desire to grab a hold of the payday that was coming and the reward that was to be won. There was a reward to get. There was a reward. There is a reward, dear people. And so let's just look at it for just a minute. Just a couple of different ways. I know I said I was going to go to 1 John chapter 5 and prove to you on some things on eternal life, but just hang on with me. Let me take you over here for just a minute. Because you're in a battle, and you better be going after a reward, because if you're not, I'm going to tell you, listen, people, I believe that so many people don't walk with God because they don't simply understand that there is a consequence to wrongdoing. They don't understand that God has given to us everything that we have need of to walk in this realm, the divine power and glory to participate with Him on the scale of being an overcomer, just like He overcame. Amen. So we see here, and look with me in James quickly. Look at James. And I guess it's chapter 1. James chapter 1, and it's somewhere around verse 9 or 10, no, a little bit later. He said, verse 12, he says, blessed is the man that endures temptation. Once again, we're talking about being in the midst of a conflict. We're talking about having imposed upon you this option or this opportunity, if you would, to go ahead and engage in the pleasures of sin, which are for a season. The tempting things about sin. It's okay, it looks okay right now. I'm going to be able to get away with it. But the Lord says the wages of it is death. The Lord says there's a consequence with it. It's a thief that's come to steal from us. It's come to rob us. I want to understand, how do I grab a hold of this place where I'm not so easily drawn away? How do I grab a hold of this realm of God where I'm enjoying the pleasures forevermore so that I'm not so tempted by the pleasures that are temporal? How do I grab a hold of this wonderful thing called the life of God and the righteousness of God where the things that are temporal and that are demonic no longer are so attractive to me? This is what I would talk to you. This is what we're talking to you about. And if you'll do what we're going to lay out before you, you're going to understand what it means to live the life of the overcomer, and no one will be able to take your crown from you. And that's what Jesus says. He warns everybody. He said, you better stand fast. You better understand the war that you're up against. You better understand the things that you're facing right now. You better understand how to lay hold of the power of God. You better understand how to walk in the authority of His Word and of His Spirit, lest someone take your crown from you. Here in verse 12 of James chapter 1, see, God says, blessed is the one who engaging in temptation, the conflict of temptation, is fighting the good fight of faith with a firm grip on eternal life. Because eternal life is the description of the power of God that is present with us right now. Jesus personified as eternal life. And we having the proofs that we have received this eternal life, which is the very life of God, the very life of the power of the Holy Ghost, that wants to teach us a whole other dimension of living that is completely contrary and opposite to everything that the whole world is excited about and running after. Hello, that you are being faced with, you are being tempted with, you are being threatened with, that has a dire consequence if somehow you are willing to participate with it. For this reason, God was manifested in the flesh. This is the reason that Jesus Christ was born in Bethlehem. This is the reason He was incarnated. To become a human being, to take on the garments, the robes of sinful flesh, to condemn sin in the flesh and say it does not belong here. Amen. Any human being can overcome it.
Amen.
Any human being can overcome all sin.
Amen.
That's what he proved. Any human being who will come and follow me and do what I showed you how to do and live the kind of life that I'm now presenting to you and give you can have the same kind of life that I have. Now, this is a big shift because now all of a sudden you can't sit around and enjoy the pleasures of Egypt anymore. You can't get around. You know, people tell me, well, you know, I'm having to deal with these thoughts continually. Well, you're having to deal with those thoughts continually because you're pouring a bunch of nonsense into your head. You're sitting there communing with all kinds of evil in so many different dimensions of your life. And one of those dimensions is what people get through the media of television, the media of movies. They're just filling themselves. They've got an empty hole in their life of loneliness, a place where God hasn't been allowed to dwell and where the importance of this life in God has lost its value and its meaning. And so they're going and stuffing themselves with all these things that belong to fleshly lust and then wondering why it is they can't lay hold on God. You're going to have to be willing to come out from among them and be separate.
Amen. Amen.
You're going to have to be willing to go and take a hold of the reproaches of Christ. Amen. And be somebody who's, you know, kind of weird and oddball, doesn't run after the same kind of pleasures that the rest of the world runs after. I would rather have the sufferings and the afflictions of Christ rather than the pleasures of sin.
Amen.
For a season.
Amen.
You have to decide here tonight.
Yeah.
Amen.
Three amens. And the rest of the people are captivated by Christmas. Too much sugar. Sugar toast. Like comatose, sugar toast. Toast, T-O-A-S-T. Blessed is the man that endured temptation. For after that he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life, which fades not away, which the Lord has promised to them that love him. What's going to happen if you love the Lord? You're going to obey him. Amen. But you know what? You got to find the authority and the power of the spirit of obedience. Yes. And if you haven't been able to find the power and the authority of the spirit of obedience, you're going to constantly be overcome with the situations that are about you, the setups where Satan lays snare for your feet, the slippery slopes that you find yourself in certain situations and circumstances, and you're going to collapse and fall. And how big is the fall going to be? Well, the Lord will keep the saints, the steps of his saints, so long as they realize that they're not going to prevail by their own strength. The wicked will remain in darkness. They will not be able to have any light. They'll if you're in darkness and it's really bad dark and you're out walking where there's a bunch of holes. Huh? Come on, people, listen to me. I had some Egyptians who were trying to rip me off one time. And so they took me into this place. They were going to show me all these artifacts that nobody else could see or could get to. And I was adventurous enough to go with them. And what they did was they led me into these places where they did all of these archaeological digs. But what happened was every one of those camouflage pits that went way down, boreholes that went way down to the earth, I saw every one of them. I walked around every one of them. They were kind of looking at one another because they're leading me right to them. And I walk around every one of them. I could just like, as though I had been there and I knew where everyone was. And I said, okay, now where are we going? And now they're all kind of getting really sketchy on me and whatnot. So I got to actually go inside of the Great Pyramid, which nobody was allowed to go into. They thought they were going to trick me and get me, you know, trapped and try to, you know, probably extort some money out of the people that were with me or whatever. Come on. Listen, Satan is doing those things all the time. Fortunately, it wasn't the dark. I have very good peripheral vision and the ability to discern what's going on around me. I'm very aware of my environment. You know, I'm watching where they're stepping. I'm stepping exactly where they're stepping. I can see their footprint in the sand. I'm going right where they're going because I know that they're... Huh? Come on, are you listening to me? Yeah. There's no difference about this in terms of what we're dealing with spiritually. But if you're walking in darkness, you don't see nothing. You're taken by every pit. Your foot trips over every little snag. Every little snare takes you. Satan is able to come at his will and take you off into his stuff. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you continue to allow that, there's going to be one grandiose big event. And that big event is going to cost you your eternity because you never learn how to overcome. The Lord says, if you learn how to overcome, just overcome as I overcame. How did he overcome? He learned obedience to the things which he suffered. He went through all kinds of situations of dependency upon God, trusting God, not willing to bend or bow, not willing to back down, standing no matter though it looked like it wasn't going to go anywhere, no matter even though it looked like it wasn't going to work out. He stood the test, even as Abraham stood the test. All faith was some total of faith was summed up in him, and he's a model to show us how to walk this out. I told a bunch of people down at the ranch and a couple of them that are involved in the mission training part of the ranch, and I said, listen guys, the mouse house, we call it the mouse house, that's what I call it. I said, the mouse house is going down. It was supposed to go down in June and then go down in June. And I started giving people a countdown. I said, at 4 weeks out, I said, listen, you got to get all of your stuff out of there. 3 weeks, I said, hey, you got all your stuff out of there. 2 weeks, I said, better have all your stuff out of there. 1 week out, I said, there better not be any of your stuff in there. One morning I got up, I got on the backhoe, and I took that big old backhoe bucket, and I went swoop. And people are panicking. And I said, it's like the coming of the Lord. You do not know when it's going to happen. It's suddenly, but you were warned again and again and again. Oh, but my and this and that does not matter. Swoop. Collapse. It's done. I took down a house in less than an hour, completely leveled it and demolished it. Laying down one side of the thing, then laying down the other side of the thing, then chewing the one side out to tip it over. Are you listening to me? Listen, in the suddenlies of God, he warns us, and we think, well, we've got time. Well, there's going to be this going to happen, and that event's going to happen. How do you know this is going to happen? And how do you know that event is going to happen? You were warned again and again, get your stuff out the world. You are one warned over again, get your stuff out the mouse house. You're warned over and over again, quit messing around with the things that belong to the pleasure of sin. That is for a season. So, oh man, there's a lot to enjoy there. There's fortune, there's fame, there's all kinds of everything that, I mean, with respect to Moses, I mean, that was the extreme. He had everything that royalty that could be afforded to royalty, that could be afforded to mankind at that level at his disposal. And he put a big value of zero on it. And he put a big value of everything I want on the reproaches of Christ and the afflictions and the suffering of God's people, because he was able to see where they were going. There's a reward with them. There's an inheritance with them. There is a life eternal in Christ Jesus, a life eternal in God that is there. That's more valuable. Anybody who's got any kind of perception, any kind of smarts, says, wait a minute, what do you say? I get to enjoy a whole bunch of stuff now, and it's going to just last for a few years, and then after that, it's going to be an eternal destruction, or I can experience suffering and going without and having to say no to the things that everybody else is running after, and it looks like a lot of fun to have eternal life and to go on in the joys of everything that belongs to true life forevermore. It doesn't take a genius to figure out which one to go with. Huh? Yeah. Come on. I've got a dog who learned one act of discipline. He's got it. One act of discipline. I go, Lord, I want to be as smart as my dog. Please make me as smart as my dog. I want to be as obedient, as cooperative as a dog. What's wrong with you and me? Hey, we've got to learn how to participate with God. We've got to understand where the strength is at, where our strength is at, where our divine power is at. We've got to take a firm grip on what's been given to us and not let it slip at any time. We've got to understand the value of what it means to talk to Father. I know how people can talk to the Father. I can listen to you talk to the Father and tell you how much you're talking to the Father. I can hear how passionate you are about that and how that passion has been developed. Those things are developed because you give yourself to it. If you're going to strive for masteries, you're not going to be crowned unless you strive lawfully. Listen, people do this for a corruptible crown, but we're doing it for an incorruptible one. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound something like 1 Corinthians chapter 9, like verse 27 to you? You reckon that has any meaning or application to my life right now? That I'm going to have to understand how to engage in a fight and recognize that my soul is what is on the line, not somebody else, me. And that it's not just something without consequence that I can just choose to do this and it's no big deal. No, because the bucket's coming out. The backhoe's coming out. Sudden destruction is going to come. Daniel's going to go back next week and he's going to finish the job. I piled it up and he's going to light the match. And the same thing is going to happen on a bigger scale with this world. The Lord's taking out the whole mouse houses. He's taking out all the trash and all of the garbage and all the spiritual nonsense that people have consumed in their lust. And it will be destroyed suddenly. The world and the lust thereof shall be abolished, wiped out, totally broken down, torn down, and lit on fire. But they who do the will of God will abide forever. Amen. This is the fight. We're in a fight. We're in a fight. And the only way that you and I are going to be successful is we learn how to hook up with the things of the Holy Ghost and learn how to not do things that we know are wrong and say, oh, well, it's not so bad. You know, I'm kind of bored. I'm going to turn on this thing. And all of a sudden you got a miss, you know, or Mr. Whatever, dancing around, jumping around, walking around without the clothes on or whatever, or barely dressed or whatever it is that they're doing, which is just a common thing of this lascivious world that we're living in. Huh? Are watching who's divorced who and who's now, you know, betraying who and who's now cheating on who. And we think that that is so wonderful and we're just all engrossed in it. You're never going to live the life of an overcomer. You're imprisoned by the lust of the world. You're a prisoner to it. You just can't wait till the next sequence in the mind of Satan to be unveiled. You're just waiting. Oh, what next? What next is Satan going to unveil in the next series and the next program? I'm so into the mind of the demonic. I'm so into recognizing who's going to get caught for cheating. Who's going to end up with who in the cesspool of lust and deceit. What? What? No, you're never going to live the life of the overcomer. No, you're never going to understand the strength of the Lord. No, you're never going to understand these things that we're talking about, of laying hold on these dimensions of God that are available to us. It is about time you and I come out and say, listen, what do I want? I mean, listen, your belief or your unbelief doesn't going to add any value to God. He's going to be who he is forever, with or without you. You and I just have an invitation to participate with him. How valuable is that to you? How valuable is that to you? Are you just going to show up, do whatever it is that you do? Huh? Play your little tambourine like Anna? And then you never pick the thing back up until the next time there's an opportunity to play the tambourine. There's no giving yourself to developing a skill. Huh? Because you're a child still. You're a child. You never put away childish things. You never were willing to grow up and put God first and pursue those things that are most excellent. So many people are unwilling to give themselves to excellence. They're slobs. Look in their closet. Look at the floorboard of their cars. You don't even have to look at the floorboard of the car. Look at the outside of the car. They're not willing. It only takes you 10 minutes to clean that mess up. So you don't look like you're from Podunk, you know, Redneckville. Give me a break. Spray the thing off. Hello. Oh, well, I like mud all over. Come here. Give me a break. Get your Billy Bob teeth in while you're doing that. Don't use deodorant. Go the whole gamut of it. People, where is the excellent? People say, "Well, I'm going to be excellent here," and they're living in upheaval and disorder. It's totally dysfunctional. There's no true commitment to excellence, and there's no commitment to just basic discipline. There's never going to be any kind of true pursuit of the value of what is expressed in this glory called eternal life. If your life is a mess and your clothes are laying all over the floor, my goodness gracious. Huh? And your bathroom looks like the laundry room unkept for the past 2 years? Come on, people. Where is the spirit of excellence? Where is the pursuit of that which is excellent? And if you're not going to be faithful with natural things, you're not going to be faithful with spiritual things either. And God said, I'm not going to entrust you with it either. That's what he says. Now, I want you to get it right. Now, I want you to get it right. I want you to understand how to get a firm grip on eternal life. The majesty and the splendor and the glory of it. If you sloppy in one area, you sloppy in every area. If you sloppy with your clothes, you sloppy with your spirit. Huh? If you're not disciplined with your food, you're not disciplined with your spirit. If you're not disciplined with your body, you're not disciplined with your spirit. Period. No exceptions. None. Understand and get it right. Don't walk around acting like, you know, somehow somebody sorted you out and did you wrong when they sorted you out trying to bless you because they thought you were wise and could take a rebuke. Hello. Yes. Hello. Amen. Come on, people. Arrogance ain't going to get nowhere with God. True. People that figure that they've got an understanding of how it all works, they're not going to see the star. The lowly shepherds will. They're not going to see the signs and the tokens of God that unveil the greatest event in the existence of the world. Huh? The Pharisees, the scholars, they got no insight. They did not hear the heavenly choir. They were stuff filled of their own religion and belief and ideology. Come on, think about it. I want you to think about it. What does it mean to lay hold, to take a firm grip on eternal life? understand how to walk in the Spirit and live by the Spirit and depend upon the Spirit, and know that those who walk in the Spirit and live by the Spirit and depend upon the Spirit shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, anything that belongs to the desire of the human realm. Hallelujah.
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 And that is so connected with minding the things of the Spirit. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Who doesn't want life and peace? We're talking about, when we're talking about eternal life, we're talking about the life of God. We're talking about every virtue and attribute that goes along with the life of God. We're talking about life and peace. We're talking about love and joy. We're talking about boldness and confidence. We're talking about assurance, you know, and every good thing that goes along with walking this out with God. What does that look like? That means I'm going to open up the Bible, and I'm going to recognize that the Bible is spirit and life. It's not just some story written by somebody who was, you know, a slobbering prophet. This is the Word of God sent down from heaven. It's spirit and life. It's spiritual food. It's a banqueting feast that He set before me. And as I give myself to it, my whole perception changes. Heaven is opened up before me. I begin to enjoy and access by the Spirit into the realms of the heavenly to behold all that is now on my side, that is made available to me, all the strength and all the power and all the glory and all the dimensions of His riches and the splendor of His glory that is mine to have. I get a view. A front row seat view of all the goodness of God.
Yes.
I'll tell you right now, when that's going on in your life, all this other stuff hasn't got a lot of meaning. It's easy to say, I'm not that nonsense. Huh?
Yes.
I don't want to be involved in that garbage. Yeah. Suddenly the things that were attracted to you becomes repulsive to you. Suddenly, the things that Satan was able to lure you with, you able to see through it. The wisdom of God allows you to see through it, and you're repulsed by it. You begin to hate iniquity. Huh? We love righteousness. Every person in this place loves righteousness. You love the results of it. You love the consequences of it. Huh? You do. You love it. And you feel terrible about any other choices because you love the life of it. You love the joy of it. You love the peace of it. You love the relationship of it. You're just going to have to let that develop into a greater insight, a greater wisdom, so that you hate iniquity. I mean, all this time, He is our righteousness. It's imparted. It's imputed. All this time, I'm walking and housing the temple. I'm the temple of God, housing the glory of God. But I'm not going to profit from what God did for the whole world until I am a recipient and participant with it. His blood was not only shed for my sins, but for the sins of the whole world. But it isn't accounted to the whole world because they're not even willing to receive and participate with it. They're not. Although that availability of sonship is predestinated for all men, they can never participate with it. They can never understand the blessing and the reward of it because they're not willing to receive it. I mean, it's receive. A receptivity of what God is doing. A participation with what God is doing. A value of it. We have got to begin to see the value of obedience. Amen. The value of a word of life, which is spirit and life, which comes and fills us with heavenly strength, with divine power, with divine ability. His word works mightily within us. It gives us insight to discern between right and wrong. It gives us a perception, a keen perception. Know what God is doing so that we be kept, so that we're kept by Him. And none of our feet, none of our steps slip. None of the snares take us. The wicked walk in darkness. They can't see. They're going to slip and slide and trip everywhere. We don't. We walk in the light of His Word. We get a whole new perspective of life because we're beholding Jesus. And beholding Jesus, we're seeing the fullness of God. We're seeing all heaven open. We're seeing everything that we need to know and understand so that we can move with and cooperate with the faith that God has given to us to subdue nations, just like He gave to Elijah and his servant, who thought that his servant thinking that he was going to have the end of his life having to come up against the Assyrian army until his eyes were open, till his ears were open, till his heart was made to understand because the heavens opened up before him and he was able to see what surrounded him. God wants us to have an encounter that allows us to begin to function in the spirit of wisdom and revelation. He desires this. How is it going to happen? Because we engage in prayer. We little value the power and the authority of prayer. Yet Jesus has placed the whole meaning and value of his life to ever intercede and pray for us. If we understand the beauty of prayer, where we are participating with the Holy Ghost, and it's not just some boring exercise of hearing somebody mumbling. Yes. Some passionateless prayer, as they call it, prayer. Now, man, prayer changes and changes things and moves the atmosphere around. Fills us with the divine revelation and glory. Paul said, I do not cease to pray for you and ask the Father to fill you with the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, so that the eyes of your understanding could be opened. See, how does that come? Prayer. Where you and I begin to make requests before God, when we begin to engage in something that we think is humanly possible to do, but it's not. It is a supernatural power that God gives us the ability to function in, and that we've got to be willing to participate with before it's ever going to be effective. Before it's ever going to be effective. Prayer becomes effective when it's fervent. And it proceeds forth from a righteous person. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, Jude gives us a wonderful understanding when he says to us, he said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. What a place. I know how to be strong. Amen. Next. And spend 3 hours doing something that is completely nothing but carnal and earthly. Your little step didn't do nothing for you. It's only the prosotabit is going to do something to you when you move past that which is normal and you touch the realms of the supernatural. When you learn how to access the realms of heaven by the Spirit, you have access unto him by the Spirit. When you accessing God, we're talking about being strengthened. Paul said, finally then, brethren, be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. The big issue is, how are you going to get that strength? And how are you going to get that power? And how are you going to get that might? Because without it, you're not prevailing. Because, listen, you're up against spiritual wickedness. You've got to have what God's got to succeed. You have to have the same thing God has. Take unto yourself the whole armor of God. That's not some Roman armament. That's what God has. That's what he's armed himself with. Amen. God says, you can arm yourself. I'll let you be armed with the same armament that I have. Hallelujah. 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 There is nothing more effective in prevailing as the shield of faith.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one. Everyone, not some of them.
Amen.
Everyone,
amen.
Everyone. Amen. People, you and I are without excuse. Because you start standing before the presence of the Lord, telling the Lord all of your excuses, Moses is going to look over at you and go, what? And of course, you know, you can't lie when you stand in that kind of truth. No. You can't lie. You try to lie and it says, tongue cleaves to the roof of your mouth. Then you can't lie in the truth, in the presence of the truth. A lie can't work in the presence of the truth. Huh? The darkness can't work in the midst of the light. You need to get over. You need to get yourself baptized in the fire and the glory of God. There needs to be the fire of God. Father wants his fire to be the truth that is, we've been baptized in the fire. He wants it to be manifested in the fiery nature of our prayer. You know when somebody's prayer is fiery. When I pray, you go, that's fiery. Not only you, but everybody I've ever known. So that guy knows how to pray. I don't agree with him in his doctrine, but he knows how to pray. Fine. It's fine with me. I'm fiery in my praise. God wants to baptize you in fire so your praise becomes fiery. And not just emotional, not just embarrassing, that's fiery. Hallelujah. God wants to fill you with fire in your passion towards him. There wants to be a fire of fervency towards God. Hallelujah. Otherwise, lukewarmness sets in. Apathy sets in. Slothfulness sets in. Sweeping the dust under the rug sweeps in. Leaving a pile of mess in the closet slips in. I walked in, Ann's laughing. I walked in one day, we're out having a conference in Lake Mead many years ago. Just people get together. I walked in, and the guy whose house we were staying in, he was in, I just caught him as he had picked up the rug and he was sweeping the dirt underneath the rug. And I stood there watching him while he's bent over. I'm sitting there watching. I said, no, I'm looking at him. And I'm like, I'm just appalled. I said, is that your spiritual life, man? If somebody would have said that to me, I'd have picked up that rug, I'd have taken it outside, I'd have dusted that thing off, cleaned up the mess of how long he'd been sweeping that dirt on that rug under the nose. Who knows what all was underneath that rug in the first place? I mean, from he didn't do it, though. He just said nothing. He just went on and just acted like he didn't hear nothing and didn't respond. It didn't take long to reveal that that's what his spiritual life was like. Because you're constantly revealing who you are. You're constantly being manifested who you are. Constantly being manifested. Come on, people. I mean, I'm telling you right now, the way of the transgressor is hard. Being a perpetual backslider ain't going to get you nowhere. You're going to be one frustrated human being. You don't have the good things of either side. You don't have the pleasures of this world for it, which is for a season. So many people, I hope they got the best Christmas presents you could ever possibly imagine, because that's all they're ever going to have. Because that's all Christmas is to them, about getting a present, getting a Maserati, getting a this and Rolex and all the other things that many people in this area have great lavish wealth. There's a lot of wealth in this place. People talk about, oh, don't spread the wealth around. I'm going to tell you right now, there's a lot of wealth here that if it was spread around, they wouldn't even miss it. They wouldn't miss it. There's just so much wealth. There's a lot of wealth. There's a lot of opulent wealth in Southern California, San Diego. And that's all that this day is all about to them. And that's all they're going to ever have. And they run wide open and they're sitting their iniquity and just want more. They just passionate about more. Here you and I sit. We don't sit here frustrated. Huh? Longing for something as though we cannot have it that God has freely given. Come on, people. There's an access by the Spirit that you're going to have to learn how to participate with. There's a place. There is a place of being, of allowing His Word to be effective in us, His prayer to begin to take us over into dimensions where we lit up into a place of transfiguration, where we become filled with the Spirit. And when that, you don't leave that place with just some kind of, religious thing that just left you basically in the same emotional, tired state that you were in before you started. But now there is a wellspring springing, and the spiritual songs and hymns and psalms are flowing up out of you with praise and thanksgiving. You built up in your inner man by the Holy Ghost, ready to face whatever. And all these things that Satan then comes to try to throw at you, my goodness, he doesn't even have a chance, because God is before you and behind you, surround you, and filling every one of your desires and your passions and your appetite. Amen. Huh? And you need to start feeling a little bit, weak, and you just go get yourself some more bread. Amen. You just go get yourself some more heavenly bread. Amen. And when you're in the battle, when you're in the fight, there's a lot of energy being expended. Huh? I mean, when I was young, I'm young now, when I was really young, I could work most of the day and not even be fazed by it. I could work way into the night. I could work 32-hour shift, hard work, 8 minutes to construction, and I'd be fazed by it. But now, I mean, the other day we'd been working, we'd get started early in the morning, and working and having, to stop for lunch. I don't like to eat lunch because it slows me down. But then all of a sudden, 4 o'clock, I'm up on a ladder going, getting a little dizzy, I'm about to fall over. I'm getting older. I don't have the same strength. I just go get myself some of Ann's food. Just a little bit of Ann's food. I'm back. I'm ready to go. Let's do this thing. Well, why don't we have the same kind of discernment spiritually? I mean, come on. I can run. I mean, come on. Think about it. I can run many miles with the word of the Lord. Look how far Elijah ran with that just one jolt to the Spirit of the living God. He went for 40 days and, If you're not going to wake up in the morning and give yourself to the Word, you can give yourself to, if you're not going to wake up in the morning and give yourself to the Word of the Spirit, you can give yourself to the Word of the flesh. If you're not going to give yourself to the spiritual things, you can give yourself to carnal things. If you're not going to give yourself over to that which God the Holy Ghost supplies, you're going to be taken out into the things that the spirit of this world would impose upon you, because you're no match for it. You're no match for it. And the way it's coming at us, right, left, and center now, we live in a more iniquitous, lascivious time, or just as bad of a time than ever before. But it's just so widespread, and the access to it, it's not just there, it's just overpowering. It just overwhelms. It just saturates everything. You've got to learn how to navigate all of these pits and all of these snares that are all around you everywhere you turn. There's absolutely no way, unless you've got a firm grip on eternal life and you have an insight and a revelation that you are in the midst of a war and that you are fighting a good fight and you're laying hold and you've got a firm grip on eternal life, recognizing that if you endure the temptation, no one will be able to take your crown from you. Let's just look at that verse of Scripture. Where is that at in Revelation chapter 3? Look at that. It's a great warning for Jesus. Where's that at? 11. Verse 11. Behold, I come quickly. Hold fast that which you have, that no man take your crown. He that endure temptation shall receive a crown of life which fades not away. Unless you, if you strive for masteries, you shall not be crowned unless you strive lawfully. They do it for a corruptible crown. They are giving themselves to the contest. They're giving themselves to the agony of training. And it's agony. It's agony to be trained, to be good, to be excellent at what you're doing. It's agony. Sit around, powder, puff my pews. I'm a little more comfortable. Let me sleep in till 12 and get up and play for the rest of the day. And don't put any pressure on me. And just let me be a free spirit, which is another word for demonized. It's only one free spirit. Amen. Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And that's highly disciplined. Why? Because it's the spirit of obedience. That's highly disciplined. Obedience is you doing something that someone else told you to do.
That's right.
Not just doing whatever you felt was good. That's not obedience. The spirit of obedience. Jesus was shown to be the Son of God by power and by? Spirit of obedience. And he's called you and I to come and live the life that he lived, to live the life that he modeled. He showed us how to live consecrated to God. He showed us how to do this. He showed us how this works. We're without any kind of excuse here. Let's just look at a couple other things, okay? Hallelujah. Somebody said, I don't believe in God. Big deal. Big deal. Was that supposed to impress me? It changes nothing. Because you don't believe. It changes nothing. You're just stupid. You're standing there telling me you don't believe in God as you look at the miraculous and that which is impossible to explain otherwise. As you breathe the air, he breathed into you. a breath that no physiological chemistry or physiological science or clinical science or medical science can begin to explain. Come on, people. I pray tonight that the manifest presence of the living God so grabs a hold of you that you begin to enjoy His presence as Joshua was singing tonight. The delight in His presence, the sweetness of His presence. His presence is like fire. His presence is like water. His presence that's like rain. His presence that is life and life more abundantly. Yeah. That's joy beyond joy. That's love beyond life. Love. That's peace beyond peace. That's life beyond life. Yeah. It's good beyond goodness. Whew. Why wouldn't we not have a firm grip on that? Why would we not be pursuing a deeper and more glorious dimension of that tonight? When Father is all delighted about you sitting here. Huh? You guys could be sitting around eating and toxifying your bodies with all that stuff that people serve on Christmas. Bless my wife's heart. Somebody gave me a box of amazing chocolates. She got them out of the house before I got to them. I'm like, where's my chocolates? She said, I gave them away. I said, listen, I would have agreed with you, but I wish you could have just discussed it with me. So I could have maybe like got one of them. Because I promise you, I would agree with you. She's not even giving me an opportunity. She's preventing the madness. She's preventing the deception that would kick in when I look at those things. And the way they're presented to look so good and delicious. And they're so toxic. So sin. So is iniquity. So is self-will. The way of the transgressor is hard, not the way of the obedient. The way of the obedient is flooded with the presence of God and surrounded by His mighty army. It is a fortress, an invincible fortress, impenetrable force. Come on, man. Let's get on the right side of here. This is worth fighting for. This is worth giving your whole life to pursue in excellence to have it. You know, my heart goes out for people who are older and not married in this lascivious world. I mean, you've been bombarded right, left, and center, and all this stuff is coming at you. And my goodness, if there's ever a time that God's people, single people, need to learn how to fast and pray and separate themselves, it's now. Huh? Some of you need to find a wife and find one quickly. Or a husband and find one quickly. Is this true? I had this one guy, he's coming to a meeting, I said, you know, and his real help, he played the violin and everything, just a blessing to us. And all of a sudden, he's running off with this girl. I said, listen, man, why are you going to marry her? She's a Nazarene. I mean, goodness gracious. Ain't going to help nothing. She's religious. He said, well, it's better to marry than to burn. I said, you got a good point there. Got a good point there. Find a wife. Find her quickly. If that's going to solve the situation. But for many people, and for, well, really, for just about everybody, it's not going to solve nothing. Right. You're going to still have to deal with the same things that Satan's going to throw at you that you've not been willing to fortify yourself against, and you've not been, and that fortification is nothing other than the defense that only God, the Holy Ghost, can give you because you're willing to participate with them. You're willing to give yourself over to the reading of the Word, which gives to you a spiritual insight, a spiritual perspective, a spiritual strength. His Word begins to work mightily, effectively, with God, divine power in us that believe it. You gave yourself over to a communion, a prayer, where you drinking of the things of the Spirit. Hallelujah. More bread, more word, more spirit, more water, more drink, which is a drink indeed. To labor for the meat that endures unto eternal life. You know, Jesus was more radical about it than Paul was. He was really intense about it. He said, if your eye offends you, If it, in other words, if it looks like something that's supposed to be looking at, it's an offense to you. Pluck that thing out. Stick your finger in there and pull that bad boy out. Huh? Gouge yourself out. This is Jesus. This is radical. Everybody wants to explain him away. He's radical about eternal life. He says, for it is better for you to enter into eternal life having being one-eyed Jack than to be cast into hell having both eyes. Come on. I mean, this is radical. You talk about fighting a good fight. This is getting radically serious. God said, you better be serious about it because it's a serious situation. And that's the emphasis that he puts on it. It's like, you get it right. You get it right. You obey. Or if disobedience is going to have a consequence. It's called a hell. Everybody wants to explain this away. If your hand offends you, hand, you will not offend this body, this eternal being anymore. And you grab an axe, ka-chop. For it is better for you to be a one-handed man than to be cast into hell. Having both eyes, having both hands. It's better for you to be one-handed person and enter into life eternal than to be cast into hell having both hands. Amen. Same way with your feet. The serious people. I've never seen any church with people with one eye. One-handed section. 1 foot-in section. That would be radical. This is these guys. These guys are the serious guys over here. They kept going to the wrong place. No, we won't even detach. We won't even go so far as to get rid of a computer. We won't even go so far as a dedication to get rid of a smartphone. We won't even go so far as a dedication to not pass by it, to remove it out of us, out of the way. Come on, people. Come on, people. I'm going to tell you right now, if Facebook wasn't all about ministry, look at my Facebook. Every time once in a while, I'll put pictures of the family on there just so that people that we're ministering to know who we are and can see our family. I said, it's all about preaching the word. And if I didn't have, if it wasn't for that, I would not go near the demonic. It's a gateway of hell. They're everywhere you turn in that thing. You've got to know how to navigate. You've got to know how to put your blocks on there and your filters on there. And still, things will pop up. Oh, you want to go here? No, I don't want to go there. Cancel. You know, pull down menu, you know, hide. Why? Because it's offensive. I had these girls that were prostitutes sending me messages. I would send them back messages. You need to get right with God. You're going to spend an eternity in a place called hell. You demonize, and the only possible way for you to get free is to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. I never get any more mail back. They instant messaged me. I instant messaged them back. A most intense message. They want me to come see some things. I wanted them to come see some things. Amen. Jesus. Listen to me. You have no business beyond it. If it's not ministry, get out of it. Don't you have that. I'll tell you right now, I look at some of your Facebook, and if you call that ministry, what church do you go to? Do you have ear pods in the whole time I'm talking? Listening to something else? Invisible ear pods. Isn't that right? Being involved in that demonic trash. And it goes on and on and on. It's gateways. It's realms of the. It's not. It wasn't created by God. It's the realms of the demonic. You better be fenced with iron. You better be filled with the Spirit. You better be filled with the Word of God. You better be in close communion with Him that results in you being strong, the strength of the Lord and power of His might, because you're in a war. And if you don't know you in a war, you are the idiot. You are the idiot on the battlefield. Get down. You're going to get your head blown out. Jesus, help us. I'm afraid that much of the church looks like that. They had no idea that they engaged in a warfare, that there's bullets flying all around, that their soul weighs in the balance, that they're about to be taken out. Somebody duck! Jesus, help us. There's no weapon either. There's no weapon. Jesus. They can quote the scripture, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty, but they don't know what the weapon is. There's a weapon around here somewhere. I have no idea what it looks like. I have no idea how it functions. Huh? You know? It's the person, you know, with a rifle, and they got the butt pointed out and the barrel's pointed out. And they get it worked out. They get the barrel tied up against their shoulder. But when they pull the trigger, the only thing that's going to happen is their arm's going to get blown off. They have no idea what the weapons are that are not carnal, but God power. To tear down every temptation, to tear down every fortification, to tear down every offense, to tear down every demonic power, to tear down every demonic influence. People, come on. Come on. Come on! Please. A church full of Gomer piles. Jesus, help us. It ain't right that he's got us to represent him. It ain't even right. He's worthy of far more than this. You know, the ragtag, sloppy group completely have out of any kind of ranks. Just everybody walking, running around wherever they want to go, doing whatever they think needs to be done. He's deserving of something far more excellent, far more disciplined, far more glorious, far more committed, far more consecrated, far more surrendered, far more diligent. Far more real, far more true. Yeah. Come on, people, let's just be what he needs. Let's be his proper representation. Yes. Come on now. Come on now. Come on now. Don't you let time of worship and praise be a lull for you. Huh? You bring it to another level of passion. You lay hold on God. You begin to cry out to God, oh God, we need you. Oh God, we got to have your movings. Oh God, your presence, let it be like fire right now. I'm not willing to sit around and sing, oh, your presence like fire, never felt it. Your presence like rain, never felt it. Your presence like water, but never felt it. Don't feel it now. I don't even think that I'm going to either, but I'm just going to sing it because that's what everybody else is singing. That's not truth in the inward parts. No. That's not real. That's lies. It's lies. It's false. It's false. It's a pretense. Suddenly, wait, your presence is like fire. God, I got to have that fire. I want that fire now. It's like rain. It's just the refreshing water of heaven. I want that water now. And he responds when we call. He responds when we call in truth. We seek him when he's near. He's going to move in our midst. We're not going to be without him. And I'm telling you right now, if you can't learn it in church, you can't have it at home. If you can't do it here, you don't have it anywhere. This is where it's all made manifest. This is where it's all revealed. This is where nothing is hidden. Get yourself a firm grip on eternal life. Get yourself a firm grip on the life that Jesus Christ was born to give to you and me. Get yourself a firm grip on the life that he suffered, bled, and died, the hideous torments of the lash of the whip, of the cat of nine tails, the hideous torture of the crown of thorns and nails, the hideous torture of gasping for every breath while he hung there between heaven and earth. Get a firm grip on that life that God paid such a high price for you and have, you and I to have. This great gift of God, the splendor and majesty of that which the angels desire to look into. You said that they want to hear the angels sing. Well, the angels want to hear the saints sing. Because it goes beyond the praise that they could ever know. It goes beyond the worship and the glory that they could ever know. They desire to look into those things which have been given to us, set down from heaven by the Holy Ghost. They desire it. Come on, people. Have we placed the value that we're supposed to place on these eternal riches upon this glory? Huh? To be able to say, wait a minute, is there a possibility that what God said in His Word is true? Then if there is, how could I have any other response than to give my all, to seize it, to lay hold on it, to firmly grip it, to not let it slip? There's a consequence, there's a state of the heart that would result or produce within us an action of neglecting so great a salvation. Just to neglect, not reject, to neglect. Don't want to run the risk. You know, I hope that you and a whole lot of other people that aren't here tonight, and they hope they come back to their senses after they get over their Christmas, whatever. Because God's got a Christmas party tonight. Amen. Father's got a Christmas celebration He's throwing tonight. Yes. He wants us to be involved in it. Amen. And you come for the New Year's Eve service. Amen. And that you come passionately pursuing this display of God's glory, of His presence, of His power, that He's earnest to unveil, to pour out of His presence upon us. It's His good pleasure to give us these things. I just come with some religious notions, some just, you know, casual inquiry. Well, I just thought I would come over to see what's happening. You're a spectator. But no, I've come to lay hold on that which God has freely given. Amen. His life, His power, His glory, His presence, the realms of the ages made available to us. 1 John chapter 5, you know, John sums up eternal life over and again, but in chapter 5, you know, I know there's a place before verse 11. I'm just trying to find it. But you can just go ahead and jump right down to verse 11. And this is the record that God has given to us eternal life. It's mine. I possess it now. It's not something I have in the future. It's not lay hold on eternal life like it's something that you're going to get hold of later, something that a firm grip on that which you have now, the very life of God. We have it. It's ours. We know that those who hate the brethren have not passed from death to life. You know that there's no eternal life abiding in those who are not walking in love. John says these types of things throughout this first epistle. The important point is to recognize that this is what He's given to us. This is the promise of God. He's not a liar. It's mine right now. It's yours right now. It's Christ in me. My confidence of glory. It's the greater one that lives on me. Do I have proof that there is a greater one living in me than is in the world? And the proof really is, are you willing to cooperate with Him? There's proof as to whether or not He's there and whether or not you cooperate with Him. Because there's no temptation that can take you. There's no sin that can overcome you when you're giving yourself over to the leadership of the greater one. The world is defeated already. He's won the battle and has defeated the powers of darkness. The issue is whether or not we're going to find ourselves living in Him, abiding in Him, dwelling in Him, with a firm grip on Him. Because eternal life, He's personified by John in 1 John 1:3 as eternal life, and the life was manifested unto us, and we have shown unto you that eternal life which was with the Father. Speaking specifically of Jesus. The Spirit of holiness. God the Holy Ghost. God the Holy Ghost. God the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, why are you fasting? Why do you fast and pray? Because I want to know God the Holy Ghost. I want to move beyond the veil of that which is natural, beyond the veil of that which is common, beyond the veil of that which I've accepted, beyond the veil of that which I've experienced, beyond the veil of those things which I think I know, beyond the veil of that which is purely earthly, and in a passion and a desperation greater than that which I can express with my own words. Now I express my whole aching being. With my whole needy being. Yeah. Hallelujah. Come on. Oh God, I want to know you. See, it's not some passing the time. Oh God, I'm hungry. If there's a heart cry, there's a grace there. There's a passion there. There's a hunger there. There's a thirsting there. It's not some religious obligation. It's a relationship, an invitation, an opportunity. I want to get a firm grip here. I want to know you, Holy Spirit. Yes. I want to move with you. I want to be sensitive to your direction. I want to grab a hold of things that I think that I want now, just believing that you're going to agree with me. I'm done living like a kid. I want to start living like a son, an obedient son. I'm done being all caught up with my whims and my wishes and my fantasies. I'm interested in walking the mind of the Spirit, the mind of the Word of God. See, the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit is that which is expressed in the Word of God. That's why the meditation upon it, the giving yourself to it, the listening, saying, God, speak to me. Speak to me. God will speak to you as you're reading out, you know, the list of names and numbers. Especially as you become keen to what those names mean. I can preach the gospel, give you the list of the genealogies of who Jesus is. Descended from in Matthew chapter 1. You become keen to what all of those various different names mean and represented, who those people were and what they went through and how God's mercy and love was extended to them and revealed through them. People go long stretches of time without interacting with God. All they're doing is interacting with their work. They're interacting with their play. They're interacting with their social groups. They're interacting with the people at the exercise room with their exercise clothes. It's nonsense, man. It's a bunch of lies. You don't need those clothes to exercise in. Jesus, it is a lie. You're lying. You know you're lying. Jesus, help us. It's lascivious. It's iniquity. And what was it you were going there for? What was that again? Health? Keeping in shape? You're an idiot. Spelled with capital letters. I don't agree with that. I don't believe that. Neither do you. All you're doing is putting your foot in a snare and saying, Satan, pull it. I'm ready to go with you. I'm so glad I'm kept by the power of God. But I've got to be willing to be kept. I've got to obey Him. I can't go off into the places that belong to the realms of darkness and say, oh, I'm being kept by the power of God up here. The only reason I would go off into the realms of where the powers of darkness are working is to go there with the testimony and the authority of Jesus Christ to cast every devil out of the place. To get myself so persecuted and so in trouble that they're going to beat me up and kick me out. That's how much we're going to be involved. Hello. Now people have the ability to bring into their living room what they would have to have before gone out of their way and gone into brothels and gone into bars and gone into lascivious situation to have ever encountered. And now they can just walk up, turn on their television. They don't even have to walk up and turn the thing on anymore. They got a remote control. Huh? Before long, you're the remote control, you're just going to be able to look at it, just think, and it's going to come on. It's going to respond to your eyes. You got to turn channels just by turning your head. It's going to happen. It's going to respond to your iris. And just taking in all of that stuff. And you take fire into your bosom. Right out of the realms of hell. You become demonized. You suddenly go into an environment that you would never have gone into. You have to sit there and ask yourself, would you be in that bar listening to all of these jokes? As you're sitting there being entertained by whatever that thing is. As they're all sitting around, ha 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 ha. No wonder you can't get the joy in church. You've been laughing with the devil. Come on, I'm just trying to help you understand why all that mess is going on. You can't find a place of being an overcomer. You choose what you want to do. If you think that that's really what you want, sit there and be entertained by all that mess. If people talk about garbage that you personally would not allow yourself to be involved in, but because you find yourself in your secure environment in your living room, you turn it on, you sit there and listen, and you interact with it as though you were actually there. And Father sees it. Father sees it. Father sees it. And it goes to another layer with what goes on with people and their computers, their electronics. The kind of novels people read. This is amazing. Sit down and read novels that are just absolutely right out of the realms of the demonic. Supposed life experience. And if they would have given themselves to the Word of God that much in that day, my, would have they been built up in their most holy faith. My, would have they been strengthened by the bread of heaven. My, would spirit and life given them perception and insight to be able to move with God, the Holy Ghost. This is the cure, people. You're overcome because you're weak. And God's demanded that you become strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might.
That's right.
You're overcome because you're spiritually weak. You're not obeying God, the Holy Ghost. You're not relying upon the Spirit of the Lord. You're not letting God have control over your life, period. The connection that God gave us is His Word and His Holy Spirit and the activity of the Holy Ghost in our life and things called like prayer and praise and worship. And the preaching of the gospel and loving not our life even unto the death and being a part of everything that the blood purchased us to be and being so excited about the blood that washed away our sin and overcoming by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony of what God did for us when He brought us off the street and caused us to sit down with Him at His table.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. As the mighty men and women and partake of the heavenly things. When you see heaven, everything about this life will become ugly and boring to you. You will not want to be here another minute. You will not have a nostalgia about the house that you used to live in. About your dog and your little rabbit, your bunny rabbit you used to have when you were a kid. And how you played in the backyard with the neighbors and the tree you climbed. Heaven and the glory of that life and the splendor of what Father has called us to Oh, that your eyes would open to behold it, because you'll begin to groan to put off this tabernacle, that you might be clothed with the heavenly one. You'll be earnest about taking a hold of that which Father has apprehended you to have. All of a sudden, your life will become meaningless to you. It will be like the outhouse dung, because you have looked into the excellency of the knowledge of the Lord. Father, listen, people. I'm not talking to you about abstract things that you got to wait some long time to have. I'm talking to you about an opportunity of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation that Father will give to anybody who begins to seek Him. And He looks and He sees what you're doing when you rise up in the morning, where your passions are, where your heart is, where your affections are. He sees the cries of your heart as you're saying, oh God, to know you, Lord, to yield to you. Holy Spirit, I want to know how to move with you. I don't want to move in my own self today. I don't want to do my own will. Father hears that. He sees the passion of it. That's the determinant factor. It's having a firm grip on eternal life. It's having a firm grip on the reality of His life and who He is. It's having your eyes open to see what eye cannot see, hear what ear cannot hear, understand what's never entered in the heart of men, because you're allowing the Holy Ghost to show it to you, reveal it to you. Yes. Because you're looking at the one who all heaven is revealed through, all glory, all the ages is manifest through, all the eternal God, the power of God is contained all within Him. Please, Father, that all His fullness should dwell bodily in Jesus Christ, the one who is the open heaven. Angels ascending and descending upon Him. The invitation is here.
Yes.
As we pray, God's working out our ability to move in faith. As we give ourselves to the reading of the Word, He's developing our perception to be able to see into the ages. Come on, people, it's beautiful. As we praise and worship, God's showing us how to access the realms of the divine. The realms of His power, the realms of His glory, to move in the wind of the Spirit, to move and operate in the gifts of the Spirit. This, for me, it's where it all flows from. That's where everybody I've ever known that has moved in these things, that's where it flows from. It flows from this place of exotic worship and praise and thanksgiving, raptured away and adoring Him. And then right out of that same spontaneous flow of worship and song and delight begins to come forth, the expressions of the Holy Ghost, tongues, interpretation of tongues, words of knowledge, discerning of spirits, the proclamations of the Word of God. Come on, people. Come delight yourself in the Lord. 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 Come delight yourself in Him. Delight yourself in Him. Delight yourself in Him. There's nothing, no good thing He will withhold from you. No good thing will He withhold from you. Delight yourself in Him. He should give you the desires of your heart. He will delight yourself in Him. He'll make sure that everything, all the details of what you wanted in the Christmas gifts get granted. He will. He will. I woke up the other morning, Christmas Eve morning, Saturday morning, because Ann and I were moving from where we're at. Just, in other words, just helped us understand how to just downsize things, just, you know, hone some things in, just. And so we had found a place, and Ann was just agreeable. We're just agreeable. We're just saying, Lord, here we are, just Jesus. And I woke up Saturday morning, I felt a little checked. I felt a little checked about it. And she said, you know, I just feel a little checked. Sweetheart, I feel like that the Lord wants to do something else. So I sat down at the computer and I just started looking at a list of places. And all of a sudden something popped out to me. I looked at this and I said, honey, come over here and look at this. She's like, wow, what that's what I wanted. That's that. I said, you think we ought to check on this? Think we ought to look into this? I said, Lord, what do you think? And the Lord started causing me to think properly, to think right. I was thinking wrong. He started causing me to think wrong, right. So I called up. I said, you know, is this place available? Yeah, it's available. I said, can we come see it Monday? Yeah, come see it Monday. I hung up. And just we're just waiting on the Lord, just doing our things. The Lord said, go sit now. I said, well, I said to, and I said, I believe the Lord wants us to go see it now. She said, yes, we need to go see it now. You just wouldn't believe the details. We're just like, you are amazing, Father. It's all because I delight myself in Him. It's all because I worship. It's all because I just let this love flow through me that He gave. It's not that I have from somebody different from someone else. It's that I'm participating with it. Anybody who received, He gives the same thing to. I've just laid hold on it. It's valuable to me. I'm not living a frustrated life. I'm not living a boring life. I'm not living, oh, I wish I had. I don't have any of those. I have greater vision. I'm going to's. Huh? Have you noticed this year, I've heard more and you too's than any time in my life. Have you heard and you too? Does anybody else besides me know what I'm talking about? Yes. And you too. Merry Christmas. And you too. Merry Christmas. And you too. Merry Christmas. And you too. What is and you too? I didn't know we were celebrating and you too. I thought we were celebrating Merry Christmas. And you too. And you too. Have you guys been out much? Been asking to be saying Merry Christmas to people?
Yeah.
Well, you should have been hearing the and you too's as well. Okay, good. I'm glad somebody else was really involved. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I've got a pretty good sampling of this, a pretty diverse sampling of this. I went Christmas shopping. Merry Christmas. And you too. Next place. Merry Christmas. And you too. I guess that's what they've all been told to say. So I went by one person. I said, Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. And you too. I'm just trying to get some kind of other response. Come on, people. Come on, we've got to have more effect on people than what we're having. We've got to have more effect than, and you too. Same to you. Same to you, but more of it. We've got to have more of effect than this. We've got to have more of effect. There's more made available to us than this. There's more than this. He's here. And there's more than this that we're experiencing right now. And faith lays hold on it. And passion takes hold of it. And obedience to Him is an activity of every part of our being brought into an agreement and an alignment and a sensitivity towards Him. And an ability to agree with what He is saying and doing and feeling, loving righteousness and hating iniquity, being empowered with His divine power and authority. If at any time you look to your own strength and your own might and your own ability, and you're trying to figure out how you're going to finally get this right and do this right, you should not prevail. You have to come to the table. You have to come into the relationship. You have to begin to respond to God the Holy Ghost. You got to learn how to do it not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. You got to learn how to walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. You got to learn how to be armed with this wonderful mind of Christ, this functioning reality of the power of the living God that is right here in our life, giving to us His power, His might, His strength, being able now to develop, to function in spiritual weapons of our warfare that are God power. Point the lightnings of God. Wipe them all out. This is God power. Have you ever looked at God's power in the Word? He speaks and the nations are consumed. And He gave me that. He gave you and me the ability to speak right out of the realm of His divine authority, to move in His insight, His perception, His wisdom, his knowledge, his interface with the darkness of the demonic, to see right through it all. Because darkness is as light to him. There is no difference. He sees just as clearly in dark as he does in the light. Wow. Do you know what the weapons of your warfare are? Do you know that the weapons of our warfare is the Word of God, which is the sword of the Spirit? That the weapons of our warfare is the shield of faith, where we stand up in great confidence and boldness and say, I know who my God is and that my Redeemer lives. I've got your number, you demonic power, and every fiery dart of the wicked one is quenched, because by and large he's able to overcome us through fear and through manipulation, through intimidation, to harassment, assault, his little guilt trips. And come on, baby, do you understand the weapons of your warfare? The prevailing wind of prayer. To have a relationship with God as his child, and you begin to lift up your voice, and you begin to cry out to him and say, avenge me speedily, O God. Behold my enemy that is set against me. A person in this church said, I had a dream the other night, Pastor. Said, I saw the camps of great demons all around you. Hideous demons and angels of darkness all around you, coming out against you. And suddenly a light shone, and every one of them was slain, wiped out, laid out, demolished. That's just the inheritance of the Lord's people. That's just it. That's just it. Hallelujah. I was the other night in my dream wrestling with the most hideous angel of darkness. Just cleaning the floor with himself. I mean, he jumped me, sucker punched me, tacked me out of the shadows. And I mean, the prevailing power, the strength of the Lord, the most hideous lion, demonic angel of darkness to describe him. I could, but I'm not going to. This is who we are. Today, I mean this morning, just taking on the demonic spirits to try to find a place in this house this morning. What on earth? Come on, we must smack you. No. Yeah, because it's real. It's real. As long as you're just sitting around being entertained, you know nothing about what I'm talking about. You're never going to be trained to war. Your hands would never be trained to war. You'd never understand moving in the authority of the Lord. You never understand the weightiness of the responsibility to break off the strongholds of the enemy that tried to prevent the gospel from going forth, the authority of the Lord from being manifested in the people of God. Listen, Satan wants to make sure he puts out every similitude of Jesus Christ, every similitude of the anointing, every similitude of the light and the power of God in this earth. And he is passionate about what he's purposed to do. Where's your passion? You better lay hold on the eternal line. You better fight a good fight. You better understand that you're in a battle. The flesh will less war against your soul. That you have to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of his might to be able to deal with the spiritual wickedness that is set against you. You have to understand the armor of God, and that means by which he himself stands in his glory, his power, his invincible life. He's given these things to us. They're ours. Let me just finish this. I just want you to know you have eternal life. He wrote these things unto us that we may know we have eternal life. And that this life is in his Son. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to wake up in the morning with this. I'm going to wake up. Holy Ghost, use me. Use me to demolish strongholds. Use me to restore the path to dwell in. Use me to bust every lying demon spirit that has taken men captive at their will. Use me. to make ineffective the power of religion. Use me, God, to stand against every temptation, every influence of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the pride of life, everything that belongs to the realm of the demonic, and show that it has no place in me either, for Christ is in me. Amen. Oh God, I want your exploits to be manifested through our lives, the beauty of your life. That's it. Just the beauty of Jesus being manifested through us is God's exploit. The beauty of his life being manifested through us, the deaf are going to hear, the blind are going to see, Amen. The demonized are going to be delivered from their torment and their affliction and their fear. Mm-hmm. And all you and I have to do is be willing to grab a hold of that which God the Holy Spirit is supplying. And what he's supplying is proven by the realms of obedience, by the realms of the manifest presence of God's glory in our life, by the hunger, by the thirst, by the ability to war good warfare. Verse 13 says, "These things I've written unto you, that you believe on the name of this, that believe unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you presently have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God." The name. You may believe on the name that is above every name. When you believe upon that name and you function in that name and you use that name, then every knee must bow, every tongue will confess, every demon must hop to, must go, must obey. You, in that name, there is an authority that everything in heaven and earth must respond to. Everything in his name, you cast out devils.
Amen.
The authority of his name, the authority to be sons of God in the earth, the manifested sons of God in the earth, just receiving what God is freely giving, believing upon the name. Verse 20, "And we know that the Son of God has come. O come, Emmanuel." You may know that the Son of God has come and has given us an understanding that we may know him that is true. And we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. I'm in him. I possess him. He that has the Son has this life, this eternal life. He who possesses him, he who has made their lives his dwelling place, his habitation, his temple, this place where he now is worshipped. Israel didn't want to see the temple be. Israel didn't want to see the temple torn down. Even though Jeremiah is saying, no. God's going to make his temple in your life. No, we want the temple here. Well, hold up. God wants to make your whole being, your body, his temple. No, we'll have none of it. We want the building. Religion. Is a prison that will not allow relationship, will not allow communion, will not allow intimacy. This is the true God. He has come and given to us an understanding that we may know that him that is true, and we are in him that is true. And we're talking about God's Son, Jesus Christ, who is the true God and eternal life. This wonderful gift. Wonderful gift. This wonderful gift.
this wonderful gift that men would try to turn into religion and try to turn into things that are just objects of vanity. Father is calling us to such intimacy and relationship with Him so He can show us how He brought forth all of creation, and He can reveal to us and unveil to us His divine power and authority to walk in the glory that He has always existed in. And there we are daily faced between two choices: to go in league with that one who rebelled against the Almighty with his acts of tyranny, with his lies and debauchery, with his lust and iniquity, or to cleave unto God, to cleave, to go where He goes, to dwell where He dwells. Your people should be my people, and your God should be my God. Oh. Truly, truly divine love will take us beyond the human love that Ruth expressed for Naomi. Truly. Truly. Truly, He's given us an understanding that we may know Him, intimately know Him. So that we're not guessing anymore and wondering anymore and hoping anymore. But we've laid hold on, we've gripped it, it's ours. We have a tangible grasp upon the reality of His presence and of His glory. We recognize and know what God is going to do because He's revealed it in Christ Jesus and made it known to us by His Spirit. And so now we are dedicated, we are committed to functioning with it, to moving with Him. We know what He wants to do right here tonight. He's made it known. And the only thing that would keep us from that is because we've not allowed God to develop us in moving with His Spirit and moving in His glory and moving in the things that He has empowered us to have. And because we've made other things important, we've given ourselves to excellence at counting beans, excellent at making dirt piles, excellent at making houses of straw and hay, or wood and stubble, thatch. Come on, come on, come on. War, good warfare. Fight a good fight. Paul said, "I've fought the fight, I've kept the faith. Henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness which shall not fade away." Give me a break. What else would there be willing, should we be willing to devote our life to when we have the opportunity of coming to that moment in time ourselves? Grab a hold of tonight that which God has grabbed a hold of you. Yes. To do. Grab a hold of tonight without which God has grabbed a hold of you to have. Grab. And surely Satan is set against you to make sure that you're not going to have any of it. So understand that you're in war. So that you can fight a good fight. And understand that you're not going to be crowned unless you give yourself to excellence. You will not be crowned unless you give yourself to excellence. Amen. To being the very best. Amen. To being highly disciplined. Amen. To learning every lesson. To know how to do it so perfectly that you do it that millisecond faster than anybody else because you learned it more perfectly. You rehearsed it more accurately. You trained until you had it absolutely down. And that's what made the difference. They for a corruptible crown, we for an incorruptible. That's really radical the way Paul places it. And he didn't give it any less value than it was deserving of. Because God demands it all, not a part, all. And when you and I step into a realm believing that this that God has described is truly ours, then we will have no less response than all. There will be nothing more valuable to us. If you got a phone call tonight and they said to you, listen, we want you to come up to Alaska and you can have, we found this huge amount of gold. There must be somewhere between $50 and $100 trillion worth of gold, and as much as you can dig out, you can have. How many people are going to get a flight in the morning? Now come on, and please. Right. I would. I'd be on a flight in the morning. I can have as much gold as I can dig out. How many people are coming? Were you the first one we called? Well, you're the first one. Guess what? I'm the first one you're going to see. I can use that. I can use that. I got some purpose. I can dig. I can dig. I can get on the phone. I can have somebody drop me. One of those big excavation units with, 6 foot wide bucket. We'll have that dug out before anybody else gets the memo or anybody else gets the telephone call. Father's giving us an invitation, and far beyond that, what you going to do with it in the morning? I'm going to take my flight. I'm going to get on the flight. I'm going to get first flight out. I'm going to have everything set up on the telephone, get it all connected. So when I get there, we go to work. We're going to get it all. We're getting it all. I'm covetous. I'm getting it all. I'm leaving nothing for you. That's covetous. I'm earnestly covet. I'm going to be covetous about this. I'm getting it all.
Amen.
Good thing about it is God's got enough for everybody who wants it all.
Hallelujah.
So everybody can get it all. All at the same time. Hallelujah. Vitora. Mefiti fitanstan. Efitina. Mefita supata. Exti. Exti palano. Exti pranesh. What makes the difference? What makes the difference is experiencing His presence. What makes the difference is beginning to interact with His Word. You don't come to God with a true and sincere heart and be left, just high and dry, and you still don't know any more than you knew when you got started. No. You sit down wanting to seek Him, know Him, receive that which He has. You begin to apply yourself the way He said for you to do it. Get in the Word. Know my Word. Know the truth, and truth shall set you free. Search the Scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. Because He wants to take you to thinking, from thinking to knowing. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. There's none of us any different from each other here tonight. None of us. We're all in the same situation. All in the same position before God. No special people, no special. Position or place. Everybody with an equal opportunity before God. The only thing that makes the difference is how you participate, how you receive, and how you participate. It's the only thing that makes a difference between men. Sit. If you will receive that which God has supplied, then you'll learn the life of the overcomer. And if you overcome as He has overcome, then you'll sit down with Him in His throne as He sat down with His Father in His throne. You'll feast on everything and every good thing that Father is supplying. No one will be able to take your crown from you. All those things that Father has promised and supplied by His Spirit be available to you. You won't have any needs anymore. You won't have any lack anymore. When you walk with the shepherd, you have no lack. There's no lack. There's nothing I desire but Him. And in the midst of that, He gives me all things that I have need of. I let Him call it. God's not functioning on a budget. He gives you whatever you have need of. Take better care of you than you would ever be able to take care of yourself. because you put all your delights in Him and all your desires in Him. You'll never be able to save the amount of money He'll give you. Never. Never. These people out there working dog tired, huh? Night and day, saving their pennies. We outrun them by the Spirit in a day. They work years and run them. Because it all belongs to the Father, and He gives it to whomever He wills. And those that He wills to give it to are those that are desperate to have it. And put the kingdom first above everything else and don't seek it, but go after Him. That's what you for. I'm going to learn obedience, Lord.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm going to learn how to have all my pleasures and all my desires satisfied in the realms of heaven, Amen. Not in the realms of the demonic. And there's a war.
Amen.
And the only way that you're going to be successful is that you'd lay hold, you'd have a firm grip on eternal life, because there is the supply of the Spirit. That eternal life is a supply of the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. That supply is the ability of the mind of the Spirit and the mind of Christ. That is the walking, living, functioning relationship that God the Holy Spirit has supplied to us, the recognition of Him, the responsiveness to Him. Whew, everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Daniel, why don't you come and come over here and set the communion up. And hallelujah. And Kate, why don't you help, Daniel? Hallelujah. I want to end tonight just enjoying what Jesus was born to give to us. His body is meat indeed. His flesh is meat indeed. His very life. He was born to give us His life, symbolized by the body and by His blood. He was born to give us His life, something that goes far beyond His body and His blood. It is the whole of His existence, His glory. A place with Him. I always hesitate to say it because it's just too, it's unspeakable. That we sit down with Him in His throne. We sit down with Him in the throne of His authority, in the throne of His majesty, in the throne of His glory. And when kingdoms come together, there was always a hierarchy of kingdoms. There was the King of Kings, and His throne sat higher than all the thrones of the rest of the kings. Because He was the King of Kings. He was the King that conquered all the other kings. But Jesus says to us, I want you to sit down with Me in My throne. I want you to sit down with Me in My regal seat of authority and power and splendor and majesty and divine. He's brought many sons to glory. He's forever perfected them that are sanctified, set apart in Him, forever perfected. I am forever perfected. Amazing what God has done for those who want to live in Him and exist by Him. Oh, teparana sikiti diotulopo. Amrobeta sidina lulumunda pana nisikisti. These just tokens of his life, of His eternal life. He that eats My flesh and drinks My blood shall live forever. If you eat My flesh and drink My blood, you shall never die. This life, this eternal life, because it's just symbolism of His life, His divine, glorious beauty that was incarnated in the flesh, that became a little baby born of a woman. Naked. And let all the angels worship Him. Let all the angels worship Him. As He lay there, wah, wah! Wah, wah! Wah, wah! Wah! Needing the milk from His mother's breast to survive. God vested all of His glory and was pleased that all of His fullness should dwell in Him. John was able to say, no man has seen God at any time, but the Son has come to manifest Him. Has come to exegete Him. From which we derive the word exegesis. The Son has come to exegete. And He says, you and I live in Him, and that He lives in us, and what He has with the Father is ours. And when it becomes so valuable to us that it begins to occupy every part of our life, then we begin to understand how to move with the Spirit of the Lord. But when we have many other things that give us value and give us importance and give us pleasure and is interesting to us, it never distills down into Him. You always wonder. Just surrender to Him. Surrender to Him. The lies of men. Men will steal your crown. The lies of religion. It'd take away from you the privilege and the opportunity just coming, stepping up here in this place. Don't let the enemy harass you anymore. Just say, I'm going to believe the word. I'm just going to believe what God said in the word. I'm just going to believe it. I'm just going to believe it. And I'm going to pursue Him. I'm going to lay hold on Him, because everything He said I can have is mine. I'm going to have it.
Amen.
He said, he that eats my flesh and drinks my blood dwells in me, and I dwell in him.
Amen.
That's the life that He's given to us. It just represents the life that He's given. It represents a spiritual life, the eternal life. His blood, the means by which all of our sins is removed and God remembers them no more. Sometimes I remember sin of the past. And when I do, I say, Lord, I know that you don't remember this, but forgive me. Anyways, I need to say forgive me. Because sometimes when you say that, it shuts down the memory of it. It shuts down the thought of it. It shuts down the harassment of it. I thank you for your precious blood that has washed me. I just erase Satan's harassment and lie and accusation that he's trying to use against me with it. Huh? Father doesn't remember it. I was called up into heaven one day in a vision. I said, Lord, what did I do wrong? He looked over at me like I was bothering him. He said, you haven't done nothing wrong. Went back to doing what he was doing. I was invited into the room. I was there in the room. I'm in expectation going into the room in a greater and a glorious and more fully manifested way of interacting with Him than just in the dream and in the vision. I mean, we're in that room. If we had done something wrong, we wouldn't be in the room. And there was some kind of an offense, if there was some, we were out of place, if we hadn't received the invitation, we wouldn't be in the room. It's God Almighty. We have access by the blood of Jesus Christ. We have access by faith. We have access by the Spirit. I want to learn how to function in my access. I want to get finely honed and tuned in and understanding the things in the Word of God, the moving of God, the mind of God, so that I can move with Him. I can move with Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody come. I was going to say this section come. It's just like, everybody come. Come to the table. Eat of this bread. Come to the table. The Lord has prepared. Come drink of this fruit of the vine, this wine which He has mixed. Thank you, Jesus, that your body was broken for us. See, Tom Brosica, love you so much. I love you, my brother. Love you so much, Josh. Love you so much, my God. Love you so much, Eric. Love you so much, Benny. Love you so much, Elizabeth. Love you so much, baby. Father, we thank you for the bread of heaven that was born in Bethlehem. Father, we thank you for your only begotten Son that you gave to us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, the eternal Word, that you were willing to become flesh, the bread of heaven, that you were willing to take the bread and say, this is my body which is broken for you, that you were willing to bear our sins in your own body on the tree, that your life may be in us, that we may live by your life every day. Lord, I pray that every person here tonight sees that you are that eternal life, that they live by you, that they find that strength of the Lord and the power of your might, Father, all here in this communion, in this fellowship with you, that this communion and this fellowship will be unceasing, unending, continual, breaking bread, praising you, worshiping you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, every sickness and every disease defeated by the body of Jesus Christ. Every foul spirit of affliction and torment, we curse you and we command you. Go, 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 and leave the property of God alone. Jesus' name. On the night that Jesus betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take it and eat it." Hallelujah. The heavenly manna, the bread of heaven, that which represents the Lamb, our Passover. Hallelujah. Living by you, Lord Jesus, living in you. Thank you for this gift, Father. Thank you for this gift. Thank you for the gift of the Son. Huh. Thank you for this heavenly bread. Hallelujah. Mm-mm-mm. That if a man shall eat it, he shall live by it, live forever. Mm. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, tonight we dedicate ourselves to live for you beyond any consecration that we've ever had. To live by you beyond any consecration that we have ever had. To live in you beyond any consecration. And after they had eaten, he took the cup and he said, "This is the New Testament. This is the New Covenant that the Father makes for you and with you, that I prepare for you, that I give to you, sealed, signed, delivered, and ratified in my blood which is given to you. To erase, to remove, to eliminate every sin. Every sin. That there remains no spot, no stain, no blemish." God is amazing. My blood, which is given to you, that though your sins be as scarlet, they should be white as snow. Though they be like crimson, they should be white like wool. The one unto him who loved us and redeemed us. With his own blood, who loosed us from our sins and made us priests and kings. To sit down with him in his own throne. Born in the manger to pour out his blood on the cross. So that you and I might step into his eternal life. His life, his overcoming life, his overcoming power, his victory wherewith he destroyed everything that was against us and nailed it to the cross. Thank you for your blood, Lord. Thank you for this life. Lord, we eat your flesh and we drink your blood. And we receive every hard saying that you ever made. And we enjoin ourselves to every request that you've ever made. And we move in the gift of your life that you've given from this day forward, consecrated. This is our communion. our fellowship. Hallelujah. That's sweet. Sweet. That's the sweet wine of communion. There's no leaven in it. I'm sorry, but most people never really had fresh squeezed grape juice. It has been all, you know, heated up and messed with. But you get yourself some fresh sweet grape juice sometime, you can drink a lot of that. It tastes very good. It's far better than an alcoholic beverage. Jesus made 180 gallons. 180 gallons of it at a feast. And if it was alcoholic, like everyone said, they would have been in a drunk stupor that nobody would have walked home. 180 gallons? That's times three if you put it in bottles terms. You know what I'm saying? 180 times three, that's how many bottles of wine they all pump down. Give me a break. The sweet communion of the fellowship of the Spirit. The sweet communion of the body of Christ. The sweet communion of this wonderful fellowship that we have with one another in Him. We've all been made to drink of one cup and eat of one bread. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Listen, people. You know, please come on Christmas Eve, New Year's Eve. Come, because we just want to tell you about what the Lord's doing, what we're planning on doing, what God has set before us, the churches, you know, the church that we're going to get built, the other churches that we're going to plant, the doors, the opportunities that are opened up before us. We want to encourage you in your commitment to become fine-tuned to moving in the Holy Ghost. These things that Christ Jesus is committed, He's praying and interceding continually on our behalf so that we'll understand how to move with Him in these exploits of His nature and of His power and of His glory. Hallelujah. And He's training us in the way that He's training us how to do it by the way that we love one another, by the way we interact with one another, by the way that we walk in joy. Hallelujah. Ha, ha. By the way that we keep ourselves in peace, allowing His peace to rule our heart and our mind. I'm never going to step outside of the rulership, hallelujah, of this eternal life, hallelujah. I'm not going to allow anything to rule me but peace, amen, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because this is what we're called to do. And Father's done it out of His own good pleasure. So please come, let's be able to share with you, see, cast some vision for you, help you understand where we're going, and, you know, you can just begin to move in that much more faith with us for all the many things that God will do supernaturally so that we can accomplish the goal and the task that He set before us. And Father, listen, Father, give you so much heavenly vision, it'll scare you. Give you so much heavenly vision and then fill you with grace and passion to accomplish it. You guys had what, 48 people the other night, eh? 48 people. Started how long ago? Was it 4 months ago, 5 months ago? August 20th. And now 48 people. Come on. And God make you 10,000 times more than you are. God make you 10,000 times more. And everybody just begins to get, just moving. And it isn't coming up with some creative new idea. It's just going out and loving people. It's going out and blessing people. What happened was James and Sandy said, well, we want to throw a party for them. And so they just, you know, dedicated to do it out of their own pocketbook. And then all of a sudden somebody comes and Taco Bell says, we're going to donate the food.
No,
right.
Not Taco Bell.
Huh?
No, it was a really nice taco shop.
Taco shop? Whatever it was. That's good. That's good. Even better. And then it says, we're going to donate the food. And then you wanted to give Christmas presents, you were going to do it out of your own pocket, and someone came along and said, let me write the check, right? Amen.
Amen.
They'll be offended by Taco Bell. They have their places. It's just amazing the provision of God. Somebody steps out, they're willing to go all the way, God steps in. He says, oh, you're going to do it, huh? Watch me, watch me. Stand back. Behold. If you just do what God's given you to do, let God develop within you a passion. Learn how to sow into the kingdom. I'm going to tell you right now, a lot of that, too, is just the fresh, you know, fire of God began to fall on you. As you guys said, I'm going to sow into Cuba. Lord, I want to be used by you more. Just you stepped up. You sow into the things of the Spirit. You sow into what's happening in ministry that you have an opportunity to hook up with. And Father gives you your own. If you don't know how to do that, if you don't know how to hook up, you got to learn. You have to learn. And the Lord is long-suffering and very patient to teach us. But we've got to learn before we can move forward. So we just believe that everybody's going to get it. You're going to become more effective and more useful. You're going to become 10,000 times more than you are. Hallelujah. Praise God. I so want, and I'm just going to say this. I'm going to talk more about it New Year's Eve. I so want to be in Kashmir next Christmas. By next Christmas, I want to so be set up and established in Kashmir. We do not have everything that we need right now to do it. We do not have the human resources that we need to do it. We have began to take the model of sustainability to a whole nother level. The Lord has breathed on what we've done, confirmed what we've done. It is amazing what is happening with the model of sustainability and the connections that God has given us. But you know, there's miracles that have to happen. But faith changes the dynamics of it. A passion, a relentless passion. It's just, I'm not going to stand by and let it go by. I'm not going to stand still and let it slip by. You know, we got people in Cuba dragging their feet because they got all calculated in their own head. Huh? Because they didn't get taken out to dinner enough. That's what it comes down to. No, it's just crazy. It's human beings shutting down the opportunities of God. And not just any human beings. Human beings that are supposed to be God's people. You know what? Lord, find another way. People want to opt out. God, Father, find another way. Praise God. The Kashmir, my goodness gracious. Azerbaijan, Armenia. Whoa. Well, we'll watch God do great wonders. Watch God do miracles. We're just going to go to bed crying out to God, oh God Jesus, let us touch the realms of heaven, the dimensions of your glory that you've made available to us, that you've encapsulated, engulfed within your body and your blood, that you've left for us to be able to understand as we know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and move in it. No matter what all the obstacles and all the issues and everybody's little opinions. You know the worst thing to have to deal with? The opinions of people like me. Because you're not expecting to hear my opinion. You got to be kidding me. You're a man of God. I've got to listen to your opinion. And you're worried about the dresser drawers. You know what I'm saying? You're worried about where the chairs are going to end up. Are you kidding me? I thought you were going to take nations. By the help and the grace of God, you're not going to hear my opinion. I'm not concerned about the dresser drawers or where the chairs are going to be. I got much better things to do than sit around and count straws. Come on, people. Come on, get out of your mess. Come on. Let's just move with God. Let the tables and the chairs and the dresser drawers take care of themselves without your opinion and without your guidance and without your hand in it. Amen? Come on. Move in the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Champion God's cause. Because it's a waste of time championing the cause of men. It's an argument, it's strife, and nobody's ever satisfied. And everybody feels slighted and cheated, somehow misused and abused. So just champion God's cause and leave the rest. Leave the drama. Amen. Amen. Leave the issues to those who want some. Amen. Amen. Come on now. Let's walk with the Lord, our shepherd. He's going to lead us in good places.
Yes, He is.
He's going to lead us in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. We're going to wake up and lie down in green pasture beside still waters. Hallelujah. Our cup's going to overflow. I'm going to tell you right now, we're going to have every good thing. We'll lack nothing, no good thing. We will lack no good thing. You know, we were driving, we drove here the other night, and we drove through rain and snow, and people are off in the ditches and off the side road. I mean, parked in the middle of four-lane highway because of the ice and snow. They're parked in the middle of the road, in the fast lane. I'm weaving through the traffic. Because the Lord said, I'm going nowhere till He decides. So I got boldness. Just passing on the cars. I could just feel them, you know, going, the guy is crazy. Man, I'm just protected. Get out of my way. I got to get home. I made the same time as if it were no rain, no snow. I said, maybe we made the same time. Same time as though there was no rain, no snow. I'm kept by the power of God. And I'm not tempting God either. I'm kept by the power of God. I know and do by and believe. I'm not going anywhere. I'm kept. I got angels in front, angels behind, angels on both sides. Sometimes they lift me up on a hydroplane. When all four wheels are spinning, I still got traction. Come on, people. He's good God. Who loves us with an everlasting love, and He's proved it. Don't doubt it for a second. If you question it, take another sip of communion. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings, with your giving. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. If you don't love them, start loving them. If you love them more. In Jesus' name. What time will the meeting be on Saturday? 7 o'clock. 7. 7. We'll be meeting at 7. Wednesday night, 7. Saturday night, 7. Amen.